Jill Holmes, Barnardo's Director, Policy and Comms.
Hello and welcome. It's absolutely great to see so many of you here today. Thank you very much for all of you for coming. And of course, I'm hoping that we'll be joined by thousands of people on YouTube who are live streaming now all across Barnardo's. I just want to say that this is the first time we're connecting up Barnardo's in this way. We're connecting up volunteers, stakeholders and staff all across the country. There's been events around the country as well, events like this one, maybe not attended as quite so many people, but that's good. I can hear about that later. And what we're trying to do is to get everybody behind the corporate strategy, and you'll hear later about Believe in Me, our marketing campaign. We've got lots to tell you this afternoon. First, we'll hear from our Chief Executive, Javed Khan. Then we'll hear from some of our incredible young people that we're working with who are here today. And we've got some special guests lined up too, so I hope you're going to stay tuned for all those people who are streaming in and listening in. The corporate strategy is about delivering better outcomes for more children. And it's supported by the new marketing campaign, Believe in Me, because we believe in children, and it's important that children and everybody and young people believe in themselves. You may have already noticed that there's some posters around there with the Believe in Me campaign. You may have seen it on social media as well, so people are getting buying into it. And we will show you the ad right at the end of this presentation, so you do have to stick around. Sorry about that, guys, but you do, till around 5 o'clock when we'll show you the ad. So do, again, stay tuned with us. But before I am rambling on here, let's get on with the show and let's introduce our first guest, who is Javed Khan, Chief Executive of Barnardo's.
Thank you very much, Jill. I've never had an introduction like that before. That's a first. Ladies and gentlemen, what an absolute pleasure it is to welcome you here today. Standing room only, as you can see. It's a fantastic opportunity for Barnardo's to take this moment in time to share with you our plans for the future. I just want to start by saying a few thank yous. I want to thank our 8,500 staff up and down the country, in every community in the United Kingdom, who work day in, day out to transform vulnerable children's lives. I want to thank our 20,000 plus volunteers who selflessly give their time day in, day out, making a huge difference to everything that Barnardo's does. I want to welcome here today our partners, our donors, our trustees. We have with us our chairman, Tony Cohen, and other trustees, Hugh Burkitt and Dara Singh, and thank them, all of them, for all of the support that they give us. So generously, I want to welcome David Barnardo, our honorary vice president. And I want to extend a very special welcome to some very talented young people who you will hear from later on, who have joined us especially to be part of this event. Let me also welcome Debbie Douglas, star of The Only Way is Essex and a fostering ambassador for the Department for Education. I want to welcome Cathy Evans, the chief executive of Children England. And a very special welcome to an overseas guest. We have with us Deirdre Cheers, the Chief Executive of Barnardo's Australia, and we'll be hearing from all of them a little bit later. Let me also say, following Jill's comments, a welcome and a thank you to all of the staff and volunteers and partners who are watching this across the United Kingdom at the moment, live streaming in. I hope the technology is working. If it's not, I'll tell you all about it afterwards. But thank you very much for the efforts that you're making up and down the country. Now, today, as we launch our new corporate strategy, it's critically important that all of us are on the same page, that we're all pulling in the same direction, that we're connected to each other, working together to achieve the same goal, focusing on better outcomes for more children. Let me also welcome the many journalists and broadcasters that we have with us today, both here in London and in all the other launch parties across the UK. Now, colleagues, our 150th year marks a huge milestone for Barnardo's. Just think about how far we've come in that time and how much society has changed since Thomas Barnardo first started helping desperate children on the streets of Victorian London. From our humble beginnings, we now support over 248,000 children, young people, their families, carers in about 1,000 services across the United Kingdom. That's a legacy I'm sure you'll agree that Thomas Barnardo would be very proud to hear of. So we too are very proud of what we've accomplished, of the changes we've made, of every child with a brighter future thanks to the work that we've done, and of every change to law or government policy that's benefited children over that time. We're proud of the fact that we looked after the first black child in our care back in 1882, to running the first skills training program for disabled children in 1888, to opening a home specifically for the illegitimate children of prostitutes in the days of Jack the Ripper, to caring for those who were orphaned when the Titanic sank, to protecting children during the two world wars, right through to raising the challenges of child sexual exploitation back in 1994, when others wouldn't dare talk about it, to today, where we are pioneering the response to the challenges of child trafficking, female genital mutilation, and child-on-child sex abuse. Barnardo's has been at the forefront of services to the most vulnerable children in society for 150 years, and today we remain as committed to that cause as we have ever been. But friends, this year isn't just about what we've already done. It's about what we're going to do next. Our latest research out today shows that children's confidence and self-belief are at an all-time low. Nearly 90% of 11 to 18-year-olds surveyed said they fear for their future, lacking confidence and doubting if they will succeed. This is a wake-up call, I would argue, for all of us about the importance of expressing our belief in children and young people. We know that despite all the progress that we've made as a charity, as a society, as a country, in every community in the United Kingdom, sadly, there are still children who need our help. We've reflected on our history, and now it's time to look to the future. To help with this, we had our biggest conversation ever in Barnardo's over the last year. Over 3,000 staff, volunteers, children and young people, and external voices were asked to express their views. We took all of that into consideration, we reflected thoroughly, and with our trustees, we put together this strategy, which sets out where we want to be in 10 years' time and how we want to get there. So it's not just the usual 2 or 3 year plan. This is a view way beyond the visible horizon. Therefore, it's not just about responding to the issues of today or next week or next month. We're doing this because we know that's what works. The children and young people and families that we support don't just need short-term sticking plaster solutions. What they do need is sustained interventions over a long period. That's what's needed to help the most vulnerable to cope and recover from their challenges and go on to reach their full potential. We also know that short-term initiatives and pots of cash to address specific problems don't work for government or for local authorities. What we need to see is systemic change. We don't think it's good enough to step in and help children after things have already gone wrong. That's why we'll be focusing on increasingly on prevention. Children and young people need help when they've been abused or neglected, but they deserve something more. We all need to work harder to make sure they are not abused or neglected in the first place. Now, over the next 10 years, we want to build on our achievements. We want to support more of the most vulnerable children and young people than ever before. And by tackling the causes rather than just the symptoms, we can create better outcomes for millions of more children. By 2025, we want to be supporting 300,000 children and young people and their families each year. That's 25% more than we did in 2015. And we've identified 3 strategic outcomes to help us achieve this. Over the next 10 years, we will focus all of our efforts and energies on creating stronger families, developing safer childhoods, and ensuring positive futures for young people. Children and young people should thrive with the love and support of their families, but sometimes they come up against challenges that prevent this. We will support them to overcome these challenges and make sure their family stays strong. For example, Charlotte is a single mum in her 20s with a 2-year-old son, Tom. She also cares for her mother who has MS. She had just escaped an abusive relationship with her son's father when she first went to a Barnardo's Children's Center. She was struggling to cope with her son's ADHD and felt like a bad mum. At the Children's Center, she met staff and other parents who understood what she was going through. And 7 months later, she says, it's given her a whole new life. She's even signed up as a volunteer with Barnardo's and wants to work with children and young people. Now, we know there will be many more Charlottes and Toms out there in the years ahead. And that's why we will be prioritizing early support, because prevention is always better than cure. We know that the earlier the problems are identified, the easier they are to resolve. Many families with young children rely on a helping hand from their local children's center. Other families need more intense support to avert crisis. For other families, there are underlying emotional or mental health issues that urgently need to be addressed too. We will help more of these families to stay strong. Every child should be safe from harm, but for many this isn't the case. We will support children and young people who have been abused, help them cope and recover, and feel safe again. Sarah was a sexually abused person by her stepdad and was taken into care. Each time she moved to a new foster home, she was told she was too challenging. At 13, she was placed in a children's home far away from her town. She felt isolated and alone, so she started chatting to older boys online. Then she started meeting up with them. They gave her drugs and alcohol, and often she would have sex with them. Sometimes she was so drunk she didn't even remember what had happened to her. When she was referred to Barnardo's, Sarah was angry. But then she realized that her caseworker was there to help. She helped Sarah understand that the people she was spending time with were taking advantage of her, abusing her. Eventually, she stopped running away and started turning up for school. She made a group of friends and has started to believe in herself again and in her future. Now, Barnardo's is committed to keeping children safe from harm. Despite more awareness in recent years, we know that in communities around the UK, children are still being neglected and abused. And we know that child sexual abuse and exploitation is a horrific crime with lifelong impact. So we will continue to support children to recover from neglect, from trauma, from sexual abuse and exploitation, and from trafficking. And we will help them to build resilience and find their own voice. But beyond this, we will focus on prevention. We will work hard to give children who are fostered, adopted, or in residential care the stability that they need to cope, recover, and then thrive. And we will work with the police, with local authorities, with communities, businesses, schools, families, and young people themselves to help them keep safe from harm. Now, we want young people to have the best chances in life. It can be hard for some to access the right support to get them started, of course. So we will help them to deal with what can be a challenging transition to adulthood. Sam was in foster care and then in a big children's home. Then he moved with his dad, but it wasn't safe. Bad things happened to him. So Sam ended up living in a tent. He was all alone, and when he thought things couldn't get any worse, Sam's tent fell apart. That's when he was first in touch with Barnardo's. And soon he had a warm bed, hot meals, and he knew that someone cared. Now, Barnardo's has supported him into an apprenticeship, and age 19, he's now on his way to becoming a mechanic. He's got a place to live, a warm bed, and food. We will support young people, including care leavers, to move into education, training, apprenticeships, or work. We will help them to build confidence and skills, and above all, to believe in themselves, just as we will believe in them. We will help them to take control of their lives in a way that they may never have had a chance before. Now, I've set out the scope of our ambitions, and as you've heard, they are very ambitious. But that's who we are. Barnardo's doesn't do the easy stuff. Because we work with the most vulnerable, we need to think big, we need to think bold, we need to be ambitious. But to make the change we want to see, we have to start thinking differently as well. So we've identified three key areas that will help us on our journey to the Barnardos of 2025. First, we will be a digital organization. We will make the best use of digital technology and communications in all aspects of our work. We know that technology has transformed the way children and young people learn, play, and communicate. And we will embrace that technology to reach out to more and more of those who need our help. Secondly, we will be an increasingly diverse charity. We'll make sure that equality, diversity, and inclusion are at the heart of everything that we do. Our services must be accessible and inclusive. Our workforce must reflect and represent those we support. And everyone must be treated with respect. And thirdly, we will invest in being a genuine learning organization. We will learn from the wealth of experience gained in our hugely broad service base to become more efficient, more effective, and strategic. We will take every opportunity to work better and smarter so we can support more children and raise the money we need to do this. We will share our knowledge on what works with others, and we will work hard to learn from others too. But it's not just about thinking differently. We also need to work differently. And to help us to do this, we've devised a new strategic approach, and we're calling it the Barnardo's Way. Now, this has five key elements to it. Impact is critically important, of course. Our priority is always to have the best possible impact on a child's life. We will measure so we can learn from our experience and make sure we are constantly improving our delivery and use of resources. We will work hard to influence because we believe it is our duty to speak out on issues affecting the vulnerable children and young people that we support and represent. We will constantly work hard to innovate, to build on our history of finding new and better ways to support the most vulnerable. And of course, we will focus on income, generating the income so we can deliver great work for more children. We want to work strategically as a trusted partner to help transform how children's services operate up and down the country, developing strategic partnerships and alliances, and be less about bids and tenders, and more about strategic outcomes for children and young people. And along the way, we want to increase our voluntary funds so we can continue to innovate and respond to the needs of those that we serve. Now, each of these five elements helps us to achieve the others. And together, they will help us create stronger families, safer childhoods, and positive futures for more children. So this is a strategy, colleagues. It is big, it's bold, and as I said, it's ambitious. But I know confidently that it can be achieved. We will spend more on helping children and young people. We will increase the amount we spend on children's services by 25%, from 201 million in 2015 to 250 million in 2025. We will bring in more money. We will more than double our net income from fundraising and retail from 23 million in 2015 to 50 million in 2025. And those are net figures. We will bring in more volunteers too. We will grow our volunteer numbers from 15,000 in 2015 to over 25,000 in 2025. So when I say big, bold, and ambitious, you will understand what those figures represent and how we're going to focus our energies to make that happen. But look, we can't do this alone. We need the help of everyone here and across the charity and beyond. We need the help of our staff, our volunteers, our supporters, our donors, and our partners. But even more than this, we need to reach out to new networks and new audiences. We need to tell people in all communities around the UK about the work that we do, the difference we make, and why they should support us. And along the way, we need to increase our reach. And that's where our new campaign, Believe in Me, comes in. today you will get to see a preview of the advert before it goes out on television and in cinemas tomorrow. We think it's a very powerful campaign. We think it presents the 2016 face of Barnardo's. We think it's going to convey a very important message to this country and to children and young people that we believe in them. When you watch it, when you see it, let us know what you think. Thank you.
Thank you very much, David. And we're not going to reveal too much about Believe in Me until after we've learned a little bit more from our young people. So first, I'm going to introduce you to a very inspirational young man called Isaac Harvey. But I'd just like to show a little video of him first, just to tell his story.
Hello, my name is Isaac. I'm 16, and this is the type of gamer I am.
It all started playing video games. I started using my feet to do things. Because before I used computers, I used to get my mum to press the keys, so it's good being able to do things myself. Editing is quite important in my life because I'm able to share my experiences with the world.
We're here in London.
And also find it's a way of inspiring people to travel or to see what I can do and they can do it as well. This was the part where I was met with the next runner.
Isaac carried the torch in Barking and Dagenham. It's brilliant to see him with the torch. Extremely, extremely proud.
In the house and going out, I'm very independent. It's just the in-between parts I need help with.
So we're now at the Indigo Project, and this is where I used to come.
Hi.
Hi. When I was 10, 11 years old.
Indigo's there to give respite for families which need a break. Which sounds bad, but sometimes it's needed.
Coming here really helped with my independence. It really helped in meeting new people, making new friends.
And it made me into the person I am today.
All right! Whoa. Yeah! Woo. All right!
Wow. You can see what I mean, a truly inspirational young man. Could you please welcome Isaac onto the stage? Thank you, Isaac. I just want to ask you, you know, what have you learned and what's your experience been of Barnardo's, apart from skydiving, of course?
So it all started when I was the age 10 or 11, where I had respite. I stayed at one of the services at the residential area, in the residential. And ever since then, it's really helped my confidence, build my confidence. And now I help Barnardo's in various different ways. I'm now a mentor for young teenagers at after school club. I've made a video for the audit team because I do video editing. And it's a lot of fun, really, to do these different activities and experiences.
And some of your videos, are they on YouTube? Have they got good hits?
Yeah, I put all my videos on YouTube. I make a mixture of videos, mainly when I go traveling. But I also do inspirational videos as well. And I've done short films and adventurous things like skydiving and carry the Olympic torch. And yeah, I enjoy video editing and yeah, it's a good skill to have.
I know you've got a lot of followers, so it's a good job that you're following Barnardo's as well there, Isaac. Is there anything you'd like to just say about what your experience have been of Barnardo's in summary?
So I feel Barnardo's has really believed in me and it's turned me into the person I am today. And I hope that I continue to work with Barnardo's and hope that they do a really good job believing in other people so they can make me do these amazing things.
Thank you very much, Isaac. That's great. Thank you. pro. What an amazing guy. And he managed to get the believe in me as well. That's great, isn't it? Now, let me introduce you to Cathy Evans. She's Chief Executive of Children England, who will talk about the importance of Barnardo's and its place in children's charity world today.
For those of you who don't know what Children England is, I'm just going to say a little bit about it. It does relate to Barnardo's, and very much so. Children England is the membership body for children's charities in England. And it's fantastic to see some of the history on display on the walls. The history of Children England is that we were founded in 1942, while the Second World War was raging. And the children's charities at the time, which included Barnardo's, had all collaborated to make sure that children were evacuated and all sorts of things took place. To say that the national debt was made the current one look tiny would be an understatement. But charities had been doing for hundreds of years collectively what Barnardo's is still doing today. And we were founded in 1942 by Barnardo's and by some of the other children's charities at the time, as an exercise in collaborating and a commitment to work with the government at the time to prepare for the peace at the end of the war. We were part of working together so that the welfare state delivered for all children the kind of commitments that children's charities had been making to children for hundreds of years. So I and my organisation are only here because of Barnardo's. That was 75 years ago, and Barnardo's is still an elected trustee of my charity. So my charity is a testament to the fact that Barnardo's has made a long-standing, consistent commitment to collaborate with anyone who shares the passion and the commitment to children that they have. And so I'm particularly delighted to be here today to celebrate that history and to welcome the fact that Barnardo's is still going to be around, because it's a critical point for children, as was also referred to earlier. I just want to say a little bit about the context in which Barnardo's is doing all its work, but so are all my other members, the children's charities in the sector. Because to say that it's difficult is an understatement. We know that there are incredible funding pressures. We know that children are facing incredible pressure, and many, many are not getting the services and the support that they need. We're living in a very short-term framework. Politicians have a five-year term framework. 2.5 years in, they're usually thinking of the next election. The marketplaces and the councils that we look to for funding and support as charities, they are working from year to year. The marketplace has an even shorter time frame. Our contracts are 1 to 2 years. One of the things that Barnardo's has been able to do is to make a 150-year commitment to children, and is making another 10-year commitment to children today. Every child knows that what makes the biggest difference in their life is someone saying, "I'm with you for however long it takes." That's just basic family, adult commitment, and it's the most valuable contribution that charities like Barnardo's can make in this current context. There are very few people who have a vision of what things are going to look like in 2020 right now. Barnardo's has a vision of 2025, and hopefully that's a vision that can inspire others to feel that we know what's on the other side. So well done, Barnardo's, for making a 10-year commitment. It's in the family of children's charities. You're a great grandparent and a wise elder. So we have a lot to learn and to bring. And thanks for inviting me along today.
Thank you very much, Cathy, for making us a grandparent. That's very nice and wise as well. I just wanted to quickly remind everybody that, of course, we are live streaming, and it's on Twitter, and there's been quite a lot of events around this morning from Barnardo's. So let's have a look at our Twitter feed. We can see stuff there from Wales and whatever. Oh, there's one from Javid as well, saying all will be revealed, and indeed it is all being revealed today. Thank you, Javid. And we've got some more ones from Wales there. One of the things I do want to quickly remind you, there is a thunderclap Now, a lot of you are sitting there thinking, what's a thunderclap? But actually, it's a bit like a flash mob online, and you need to sign up so that when we hit press send, all messages go out to lots and lots of followers at the same time. So you've still got time to sign up. You've probably got about half an hour. All you have to do is go to Barnardo's Twitter feed, press that picture, and just sign on. It's so easy. And then we'll make a really big impact when we send out the thunderclap. We want to make a lot of noise. So if we're making a lot of noise to be heard across all of the UK, actually our next guest is telling us about just how much of a global brand Barnardo's is. And it has a huge reach. So our very special guest, all the way from Australia, she hasn't come over, flown in specially, she was here for a visit as well, but that's good serendipity, is Deirdre Cheers, Chief Executive of Barnardo's Australia.
Well, hello everyone. Hello. I'm absolutely delighted to be here, and thank you to Javed and all the staff who have made me so welcome this week. I'm absolutely thrilled and very, very grateful to have been here to be part of this, and welcome to all of you. This is truly an ambitious 10-year corporate strategy, and it's a fabulous one, and I commend it to you. As CEO of Barnardo's Australia, there are so many parallels in our work, and the challenges we face are very, very similar in lots of ways. We both support and protect the most vulnerable of children, including children whose own parents can't look after them. And we both work very hard to make those voices heard. When I came in this morning to the museum, I had a quick look at the, I think it's probably a visiting exhibition right at the front, one of those pictures there and the wording underneath it is that children don't and can't choose the families that they're born into. And I think that is something that is very salutary for all of us and very, very true. In Australia, in Barnardo's Australia, one of our core commitments and beliefs of all our staff is that we never give up. And I know that Barnardo's here in the UK shares that. So we come in when children need our help on both sides of the globe and in other parts of the world as well. We're developed countries, and most children grow up in a safe home in developed countries. They have enough to eat, they have a loving family, but it means it's easy for the rest of us to become complacent. And there are many, many people who don't know how hard it is for some children. It's easy to forget about the children that don't have the things that most of us take for granted day in and day out. We're here for the children who need our help. We believe in them. We believe in them as an international family of agencies. And we believe in them even when they've suffered so much that they've forgotten or have never learnt how to believe in themselves. With the right support, we believe children can recover from abuse and neglect, even when it's very, very severe. We believe they can get a good education. We believe they can get their foot onto a career ladder. And we believe very strongly that they can follow their dreams. So I'm proud of the work we do across the international Barnardo's family. I'm proud of the way we've driven and will continue to drive social change throughout the world and in both of our countries. We have technology, we have the internet, we have international travel, we have freedom to choose your own path in life, but there are new challenges that come with those things. The online world makes it harder in many ways to protect our children, and things like online grooming and sexual exploitation are with us front and centre. Our societies might be getting richer, but that doesn't make them equal, and it doesn't make opportunity for children equal. Not all children have the same chance to thrive. So our aim and our ultimate aim will always be to help create a world in which children don't need the kind of help that we provide, But until that day comes, we'll be there and we'll continue to believe in every child who needs Barnardo's. Thank you for having me here, and I look forward to perhaps saying hello to some of you before you leave this afternoon. And how wonderful to be able to be present to see the launch of Believe in Me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Deirdre. That was great. And I'm glad the way everybody's getting in Believe in Me into their speeches and stuff. That's great. We haven't prepped them at all, honestly. Now I'd like to introduce you to some more talented young people. Javed referred to the talent that we have in Barnardo's and the young people that we help. We've got sort of quite a few people from Bradford that have travelled down who are from the Education and Training Services, but I'm not going to get them all up on stage and embarrass them, honestly. I am going to ask one of them, is Layla, to join us, alongside Muz, who works at the Barnardo's Hub as well, so they can tell you their story. So do come on stage. I'd like you to come and give them a round of applause. Layla, should we go first? Would you like to tell us a bit about how you've worked with Barnardo's and what you think of Barnardo's?
If it wasn't for Barnardo's, I probably wouldn't be where I am now. It's been, obviously, to be honest, Barnardo's has been such a great support, great people. It's been amazing. To be honest, I don't know where I would be if it wasn't for Barnardo's.
And what are you doing with Barnardo's now? Are you an apprentice now?
Yeah, I'm doing my level 2 apprentice. I've been offered to do a level 3. So, yeah, definitely going to take the opportunities.
And what sort of apprentice work are you doing?
Business admin. Doing a bit of finance on the side and a bit of a receptionist. So it's all in one. So, yeah.
Great. Thank you very much, Lyle. That's great. And Muz, can you tell us a little bit about how you've worked with Barnardo's as well?
Yes. Well, I had the support of being an apprentice for Barnardo's as youth, a kind of film teacher. And then after that, I didn't know what to do after that, so they gave me a chance of having to start my own business, which I was planning from 5 years ago. And then I thought, this is a great opportunity for me, and they believed in me. And without them, I would have not started my business this year. And yeah, without them, I wouldn't be being where I am right now with my business and mentoring with young people, doing different projects with them.
And what's your business that you're doing?
It's an entertainment and hiring company where I deliver lights, sound and stage equipment for all occasions and events, and something like this I do on daily. So if anyone wants to do any business, I'm more than happy to help. So yeah.
Thank you very much, a good entrepreneur. Thank you very much for coming on stage. It's great, isn't it, when you think we've got all these entrepreneurs, all these budding entrepreneurs that we're making, with confidence. In fact, that's quite a nice segue for me to talk about the pick up on the poll that Javed mentioned earlier in his speech. Again, when we polled, we found that 88% of young people actually didn't have confidence. And it shows some of the amazing work that Barnardo's has been doing, that some of the young people you've seen here on stage have actually got oodles of confidence and actually starting their own business and their apprenticeships and doing creative things online as well. So I think it is important to remember that Believe in Me, the campaign that we're launching, is about believing in children and the work that we do. And I've got our very special celebrity guest that we've got on stage, who isn't just known for being in TOWIE, but actually she's been an inspiration around with fostering. 250 children, I believe, Debbie, that you've actually fostered, which is an incredible thing. So we thought we'd invite her on stage to talk to us about the work she's been doing. Debbie.
Hello everyone. It's a bit different from TOWIE. So for those, because we're just assuming, I think that everyone knows what TOWIE is, it's a reality TV show, and it follows families around in Essex. So there's probably a lot of you that haven't got a clue what it's about. But it's on Sundays and Wednesday nights, ITVB, 10 o'clock. And it is a very, very small part of my life. And what it's done more than anything, for me, it's given me a platform. And without The Only Way is Essex, I wouldn't have had this platform. So I was appointed with my daughter, who's Lydia Bright, who's actually also in, The Island on Sundays. So you all need to tune in every Sunday to The Island. She's on it at the moment. So she also has helped really a lot because she's also been asked to be an ambassador. So Lydia and I have been travelling all over the country and doing lots of campaigns to promote fostering, which we all know is there is a shortage of fostering. So that's a little bit of background about me, but I'm going to read you what I've wrote today. Fostering, of course, is just one of the areas in which Barnardo works to provide help and support to most vulnerable children and families in the UK. But I'm here to share my life lessons and my journey of fostering. Fostering is not for all people, and it's definitely not for the faint-hearted. But for me, I can honestly say, really and truly, that I wouldn't have wanted to do anything else. I've been a foster mum for over 22 years. I fostered over 250 children, from babies to teenagers. I actually have loved most of it, not all of it, but most of it. Thrown into the world I knew little about, and purely by accident, meeting someone over 20 years ago, I've worked along social services, and I've learned something every day of my life, and there's truly not many careers that could say that. I've sat in many coffee mornings, afternoon teas, gym classes and exhibitions. I've spoke to complete strangers. I have an annoying habit of doing this because I talk to every Tom, Dick and Harry. And strangely enough, when it comes to the subject of someone's career, I have this annoying habit of standing back and listening. This is quite emotional for me, so sorry. I'm normally the last to answer this question because I listen to people say, what do you aspire to? What are your dreams? What is your career? I listen to the stories of them. I'm a fitness instructor. I'm a personal trainer. I'm a headhunter. And I'm a finance analyzer. Until it comes to me. I'm a foster carer, which normally follows an awkward silence or, that's nice. Truly. A profession or a lifestyle? Well, that's up for debate. Some people see it as a glorified babysitter or a complacent childminder. They have no knowledge of the care system. I care for children who, by no fault of their own, have such significant voids in their life. I, or should I say, we, as a foster family, because Lydia would kill me if I didn't, open our homes, but most importantly, open our hearts. I am a therapist with no letters after my name. I am a mum in every possible way. I am a nurse and I've mastered every single illness you could possibly think of without going to university. I know chickenpox off by heart, measles, ear infections, and the most common one I come across is TLC. Tender, loving care. An illness which pops up very often, and the cure for this is a cuddle. I'm a teacher without any qualifications. I read at bedtimes and memorise times tables, and I liaise with schools. I'm a sports personality. I know no knowledge of biology, and the only team I support is Arsenal. Sorry. I had to put that in. I stand at sidelines in the pouring rain, but I never give up on their dreams. I'm a night whisperer, calming their fears in the middle of the night. I am their friend when no one else likes them. So I can stand tall when I say I'm a foster carer. And I can be loud because no one's actually ever said I'm quiet. I'm a foster carer. My job description is endless and my heart humongous. Because in life, my friends, nothing really truly matters but love. So please believe in me. Thank you.
Oh, thank you, Debbie. Very emotional speech. And I've just seen that Javid gave you a little cuddle there as well. Thank you, Javid, for doing that. That was kind. And actually, I'd just like to reminisce, you made me think that when I first joined Barnardo's, I remember Javid turning to me and he said, "This isn't like any other job, Jill. Once you join the Barnardo's family, it's an emotional commitment." And it is, and I have really felt that, and I'm sure everybody sitting in this room and all of you live streaming, everybody feels that emotional commitment to Barnardo's, and that is the power of the charity. So let me now neatly segue into showing you the ad, and I think you will find, I hope that you find, it represents what Barnardo's work is all about. It will go live tomorrow, so you're seeing the first sneak peek, a preview of it. I wanted to make sure that all of the staff and the volunteers and our stakeholders all saw it and understood the relevance and where it sits and why we're doing it, and heard from Javid about the corporate strategy and how it supports that. It's really important we as one organisation get behind this campaign and the corporate strategy. So it goes live tomorrow. I think it's actually the first showing is at Fraser at 9:15. I'm sure you'll all be at work, so you won't be watching because you'll be working very hard. But if you're working at home and you manage to have a look, do tune in to Channel 4 at 9:15 in the morning to see the first airing. But you're going to see it now ahead of that. So let's dim the lights, set the scene, and believe in me. What Barnardo's is all about, and it brings our live transmission to an end. I want to thank everybody for coming here today. It's absolutely brilliant to see so many people in the audience. That is fantastic, and I do hope lots of you are all online. In fact, a friend of mine has just texted me from Mallorca, who says, "I'm watching you live, Jill, on YouTube. I can't believe it." So, you know, we are a global brand. We are getting out there, and I want to thank every one of you who has tuned in today and has come today. This has been the first live broadcast of Barnardo's TV, actually. Whoa, yes, and it's the launch of our campaign. So thank you very much for joining me. Thank you and goodbye.